Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Zachary Dugan. I'm a member of Lambda Law Association and also Cornell Advocates for Human Rights. On behalf of both groups, I would like to say welcome. Welcome to the Fall of Prop 8, a conversation with Chris Perry and Sandy Steyer, the plaintiffs of Hollingsworth v. Perry. Before we begin, I would like to take a moment to thank the many people who helped make this event possible, to then introduce Professor Dorf, our moderator. We are honored to host Chris Perry and Sandy Steyer. We thank you for making the trip to Cornell, sharing your story, and standing up for your own rights and benefiting the rights of many other people. Thank you also to Deans Lukenbeel, DeRosa, and Conan, and Professors Holden-Smith, Dorf, Hazeldine, and Brundage for your support for this event. We also thank the members of Lambda, Cornell Advocates for Human Rights, and the California Law Students Association for their help and support in organizing this event. We also thank Linda Macaroni and the law school's IT facility and communications departments for their help in this event. Finally, I would like to personally thank Andrew Karp and Zoe Karpu. Without their help and organization, there's no way this event would have happened. Thank you. Our moderator tonight is Professor Michael Dorf. Professor Dorf is the Robert S. Stevens Professor of Law at Cornell Law School. His current teaching and research interests include constitutional law and interpretation, federal courts, and the relation between law and social movements. Professor Dorf is a graduate of Harvard College and Harvard Law School. After law school, Professor Dorf served as a law clerk for the Judge Stephen Reinhardt of the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit, and then also for Justice Anthony Kennedy of the Supreme Court of the United States. Professor Dorf is a prolific writer of journal articles, books, and blog entries, including his own blog, Dorf on Law. Professor Dorf has written or been quoted in several articles recently on the marriage equality movement, which now sees many cases hoping to overturn state bans on same-sex marriage headed toward federal courts and federal appellate courts. Thank you, Professor Dorf.
Thank you, Zach. Thanks, Andrew and Zoe, for setting this up. Among the things I do, I edit a book called Constitutional Law Stories, which tells the stories behind big cases in constitutional law. As sure you're aware, there is a whole series of these books in different subject matter areas. So for me, this is a special treat to actually have an actual constitutional law story come to life before us. So I want to add my thanks to those expressed by Zach, to Chris and Sandy. And in a few moments I will introduce them, but just in case any of you have not been paying attention for the last 5 or 6 years, I was asked to give a brief overview of the litigation that bears Chris's name. And so I'm going to do that, and I hope you'll bear with me. This should be familiar to most of you, and as I say, if it isn't, you haven't been paying attention. So, in 2008, the California Supreme Court found that the California Constitution, the Protection Clause of the California Constitution, guaranteed the right of same-sex couples to marry on a legal basis with opposite-sex couples. And not long after that, however, a ballot issue that had already been slated for the California ballot in November, known as Proposition 8, was also passed, and that basically rolled back what the California Supreme Court had done earlier that year, except that in a subsequent decision, the California Supreme Court held that the couples who managed to get married in that narrow window between the California Supreme Court decision and the passage of Prop 8 could stay married under California law. But for all same-sex couples who wish to marry in California, no longer could under the terms of Proposition 8. At that point, a lawsuit was organized, the lawsuit that we're here to talk about, that eventually came to be known in the Supreme Court as Hollingsworth against Perry. That suit alleged that in rolling back and thus denying the right of same-sex couples in California to marry, California violated the United States Constitution. And of course, as I'm sure you all know, lawsuits of this sort had been filed with varying degrees of success and increasing success in state courts since the early 1990s. The Hawaii Supreme Court in the 1990s found there wasn't a right. The Vermont Supreme Court did. That was then tweaked to become a right to domestic partnership. And of course, the Massachusetts Supreme Court in the Goodrich case found a state constitutional right to same-sex marriage. But nobody up until that point had the audacity to bring a case under the U.S. Constitution. And part of the reason for that is that what you might think of as the organized public interest LGBT rights bar was afraid to do so for fear that in doing so too early, they might get a rejection of the case by the U.S. Supreme Court, and that would lock in bad law for a longer period than if they waited a few years and brought the case. Nonetheless, assembling a team of highly regarded lawyers led by David Boyce and Ted Olson, a group of plaintiffs and some organizers brought this lawsuit. And there was a trial in the district court before Judge Vaughn Walker. And in that trial, the state defendants refused to defend Proposition 8. Right? That is to say, the statewide officials in California declined to defend it. They said, we agree, Prop 8 is unconstitutional, but they continued to enforce Proposition 8, even as they were saying it was not constitutional. The sponsors of the ballot initiative were permitted to intervene in the district court to defend it. And after trial, on the merits, Judge Walker ruled that Prop 8 was indeed unconstitutional. The state defendants said, okay, fine, now we will stop enforcing it, and we don't want to appeal. But at that point, the sponsors said, well, we're going to appeal. They did. There was a long series of arguments in the Ninth Circuit. The Ninth Circuit eventually said that the ballot initiative sponsors had standing to defend Proposition 8, but that it was unconstitutional. And Judge Reinhart, my former boss, wrote an opinion that was designed to get the Supreme Court to deny review. He wrote an opinion that basically said, well, the problem here is that California gave the right and then took it away, and in taking it away, the voters of California acted out of amicus. This was designed, the reason I say this was designed, number one, I know Judge Reinhart. But number two, it was a California-only rationale. And so the hope was that he could vote for the plaintiffs to strike down Prop 8, find a right to same-sex marriage, but not invite the Supreme Court to take the case and potentially reverse it, because he too shared that worry of a lot of the rights bar. In any event, that didn't work. The Supreme Court took the case anyway. And there was an oral argument, and on the same day that the Supreme Court decided in the Windsor case that the Defense of Marriage Act is unconstitutional, the court found that there was no standing on the part of the ballot initiative sponsors, which had the effect of leaving in place the ruling. And very, very shortly thereafter, California executive officials said, okay, we're not going to enforce Prop 8, it's a dead letter, and same-sex marriage became legal in California. So that's the law story as we talk about it in law school. But today we want to talk about what's the story behind the story. And so for those purposes, I want to introduce to you our guests. Chris Perry and Sandy Steyer, the lead plaintiffs in the Perry case, have been together since 1997 and are the parents of four boys. Perry is executive director of the First 5 Years Fund, a national organization that helps America achieve better results in education, health, and economic productivity. She holds a BA from the University of California, Santa Cruz, and an MSW from San Francisco State University. Steyer is the director of information systems for the Alameda County Healthcare Services Agency, originally from Iowa. She holds a BA from the University of Iowa, an MPA from Golden Gate University. They first tried to marry in 2004 after San Francisco began issuing licenses to same-sex couples. And after helping to strike down Proposition 8, they became the first LGBT couple to wed in California in June 2013. They're going to give us a presentation, then we'll have a little bit of back and forth, and then we'll open it up to questions. So please join me in welcoming Chris Perry and Sam.
Strategy. Obviously, we decided it was a really good idea to sue the state of California. That was the legal strategy, and you heard why that happened. And then there was a second strategy that really had to do with increasing public will and doing that through public education. That was one of the sort of dual roles that we played. We were obviously testifying and plaintiffs in the case, but we are also speaking to the media and to the public about why we wanted to be married and why we felt that we should have the same rights that other people have. The third and final strategy was one that was sort of political, I guess, with a little p, in the sense that lawyers were chosen who had identified with different ends of the political spectrum, and they were partnered to in a sense, depoliticize the issue. And that third strategy, again, was a part of our role. We didn't go into political messaging. We weren't ideological. Our team often argued the case from a very factual and evidence-based place, whereas the other side was often referring to sort of tradition and religious beliefs, religious freedom. And so we were taking a different path. And those three strategies will weave throughout our conversation with you tonight so that you can see where, at different times, we were trying to highlight different parts of that strategy.
So we're going to talk for a moment, and I will try not to repeat anything that you've already heard so far about this, about how do we get into the into entering this case in California. Well, when Prop 8 passed in California, you may or may not know this, but it was the result of a major marketing campaign by religious groups primarily from outside of California. So it was money coming in from outside of the state to a major media campaign to scare people into thinking that marriage equality in California would be bad for their children, and that was the basis. So what we did, we came together, and this legal team came together before Chris and I joined the case. So the case was first thought of by a man named Chad Griffin. He is currently the director of HRC, and he was working with Rob Reiner and his wife, Michelle, and they were having a conversation about Prop 8 passing and what a bummer it was and how bad it was for the state of California, for LGBT people, and the message it sent to kids. And the result of this conversation ended up in a side conversation with a friend who said, you should talk to my brother-in-law, Ted Olson. You'd be surprised to find he's on your side in this issue. So they did go ahead and get together with Ted Olson, who is the guy with the glasses in the middle, the blonde hair. And he said that he indeed was, this is a great surprise to everybody, because he is known to be a very, very conservative lawyer and in fact represented Bush in the Bush versus Gore lawsuit with his adversary, David Boies. Now, Ted Olson chose David Boies to be his co-counsel in this case because he felt like in doing so, he would have a nonpartisan leadership would send a major message to the country and to the courts. And then we came along for the ride later.
So the American Foundation for Equal Rights that chose then Ted and David and had developed this three-tiered strategy were looking for plaintiffs, and we were very fortunate to be chosen, and there's a lengthy story behind that that frankly is covered in many books of other things. We won't go into it. Luckily, we were chosen. And I think it was chosen because we were chosen because we are so ordinary. There is a way in which our lives, I hope, track very similarly to yours. We grew up in small towns. We have parents. We have family members. We've participated in activities in high school that I have a feeling some of you participated in yourselves. And we grew up and started a family, and in fact, later blended our families, and really felt like we were like everybody else. What was the big deal? We weren't really doing anything that anybody else wasn't already doing. In fact, we were almost more mainstream than everybody else. And that was partly why I think we met, fell in love. We met 16 years ago. We've been together for 15 years. We tried to get married 10 years ago in 2004 when Gavin Newsom allowed that to happen. That was later revoked. So when the moment came for us to try to get married again, and boy, we've been married a lot to each other. Something that hopefully you don't have to go through that. But eventually we decided that we were just going to have this family and we were going to get married on our own, no matter what.
So let's talk for a minute about our lives on trial. One of the things that happened to us during the court process, it was very, very surprising, is that we had a trial. We never expected to have a trial. We expected it to be administrative, procedural case, and our names would be associated with it, but really from a fairly passive stance. So it's a great surprise to us when in the middle of court one day, Judge Von Walker said that he was asking for a trial. And our lawyers were equally surprised. So when you're involved in a trial, of course, what are you going to do? You're going to prepare for it. So the first thing we did was start to meet with the lawyers and prepare for our depositions. And that was just the most fun thing of all. Who doesn't want to be deposed by, somebody from the Alliance Defense Fund? That's exactly what happened. Our deposition prep was amazing. That's when you get to know your lawyers. And our prep was primarily done by some of the junior lawyers, Gibson and Dunn, they were responsible for preparing us. We got to know them very, very well. They gave us brutal questions and really pushed hard to make sure that we would be able to withstand the questioning. And we went to some very uncomfortable topics that we did not want to talk about, but we had to. And they did a great job. And then when it came to the actual deposition itself, of course, my favorite part of all was I object. You're getting these very odd questions, and I was particularly, I was interrogated, is how it felt. Because I have been married before to a man, and they really pushed me on the immutability issue around sexuality. And so in the actual deposition, when they asked questions, if something felt particularly awkward, I would just look to the counsel and think, you will be objecting, won't you? Surely you will now. And they did. And we felt very supported and very protected by our counsel. And that meant everything to us. And here is just an idea of how one gets depicted in court by an artist as well. Angry and worn out. But this is how we enter trial.
So this is where I wanted to talk to you a little bit about your future role as attorneys, and I imagine you will interact with plaintiffs who don't know anything about the law, don't even know whether or not they should be plaintiffs. They're sort of reluctantly participating because they fit a profile of who they hope America will relate to, will understand, might actually empathize with. And so what we had to do was this incredible partnership between the legal minds and regular people over a number of months, and that was first, obviously, depo prep, which Sandy referred to, and then, of course, deposition, but then trial prep, which was, frankly, very, very, very difficult. The amount of exposure that you're afraid of and you prepare for interfered with your ability to be open and uninhibited. And it took a lot of different lawyers at different times coming in and gently moving us through difficult subject matter. Some of this is very personal, because if you've been in a minority group, you know that much of what happens to you is quite painful. It's difficult to go back over it. You try not to remember it. A lot of it has to be, be prompted over and over and over again to come up with examples in your daily life of how you've been discriminated against and how it's causing you harm. I also had to do, and Sandy did too, talk about how this has been harmful to our children and to our parents and to other people who love us. So it's a very long, drawn out, actually psychological process to get to a point where everyone's comfortable with you going on the stand and giving your story in a way that not only will be factual and meaningful, that will later tie to expert testimony that's coming about the meaning of marriage, the history of marriage, the importance of marriage, so that your testimony hopefully will ring in their ears throughout the trial as the real people who said, my life is not the life I should have. I should have a better life than this, but I'm being told by my government that I'm not as good as other people. And so that is how the trial began. Was with us saying that in our own personal way and getting the testimony to follow from there. The main arguments that were being promoted at the very beginning and were supported by the testimony, you all know this, it's rather simple. It was that we thought we needed due process and equal protection. And those were the primary arguments that Tettleson opened the trial with and closed the trial with, and we thought that Prop 8 violated.
So then we got in, so the first day of the trial, were the first four witnesses, we were among those witnesses, and day one was one of the other plaintiffs, so there were four plaintiffs, a gay couple, this gay couple from Los Angeles, and then us. Day one was Jeff Cirillo in the first part of the day, and he talked about his experience and the harms that he had endured, and then Paul Katami, his partner, was the second plaintiff. Paul was the only one who, in the end, had to go through cross-examination. The rest of us did not. And it's because we found out kind of later on, the other side felt like it wasn't going to help their case to cross-examine us for the most part, and they felt like it would only make them look like they were pushing too hard and intimidating us, and it would come out as a negative for them. So after Jeff and Paul did their testimony, then we got to 2 hours. And Chris and I testify kind of just the same things we were prepared for, but you know, we had this major advantage of having our lawyer who knew so well, at that point, Ted Olson, he did our questioning. David Boyce had actually prepared Paul and Jeff, and he did their direct examination. So we had practiced a number of times with Ted. It was actually very grueling, but also quite satisfying because he became so emotionally connected to us. And I can't stress that enough, how important that is, because you have to feel comfortable to go up and do your best and speak clearly and in ways that will be compelling and convincing for the court and make sense. And he really helped us gather our thoughts and prepare for that. So when we were on the stand with Ted's direct questioning, it felt very familiar. And he felt very friendly and supportive. And for us, we looked right at him and had a one-on-one conversation, because as we said, that the courtroom and being on the witness stand is a very vulnerable place to be. You're the only voice in the courtroom, and everybody's listening to you. And, you know, before we testified, we didn't know if there would be cameras in the courtroom broadcasting this entire trial on YouTube or whatever. That would cause a certain amount of anxiety, not knowing what would happen, if there would be cameras, and if it would, we'd be cross-examined. But in fact, in the end, cameras were not in the courtroom, and that was reflective of the Supreme Court decision not to allow them into the courtroom, and we were not cross-examined. So then we go into the other witnesses, and this is where, you know, after we testify, then we could let our hair down and actually enjoy the process. And we felt like over the next 12 days, we got a PhD in the history of marriage and marriage equality because we got to listen to amazing experts bring forth their testimony around things like the history of marriage. And you can see some of these great quotes that, you know, these esteemed professors from different universities bring forth in their research. And to share it with the court and to enter it into the trial record was an amazing gift of Judge Don Walker. And his insight was really quite fantastic on this issue.
Nancy Cott has testified in other marriage equality cases, and she, so, you know, they go to real time, us at the beginning, and then they go back to the beginning of time, and then most of the expert testimony followed from there almost chronologically. But Nancy Cott was asked this question about whether or not, does the institution of marriage ever change? And she said, It always changes. In fact, if it didn't change, it wouldn't continue to be an institution. And she gave numerous examples, and the most compelling example she gave was during slavery. What, the way that slaves could express the fact that they were free was that they could marry. And if they did it in droves because they could finally say, I do, with the power I do must have. And that was a very important moment, as well as talking about the Loving case and how our president, his parents had attempted to marry in Virginia in 1967, could have been charged as felons for that. And this is someone only 40 years ago, 50 years ago now, who has become the president of the United States. So she was trying very hard to show very clear examples of when the institution of marriage had changed to keep pace with the way we change. And that was one of the more really powerful moments in the trial. There were also other professors from UCLA, someone talking about the importance of marriage. And this tends to get brought up. Pagan asked a similar question, and other people have about, so what's the harm? What's going to happen to the straight couples in America if gay couples get married? So she does. It's very hard for me to imagine. You would have a happily married couple who would say, Gertrude, we've been married for 30 years, but I think we have to throw in the towel because Adam and Stuart down the block got married. And this is, you know, really, there was a lot of humor in the trial. The testimony at times made people laugh, and at other times it made people cringe. But, you know, we like to share these great quotes because I think it gets at the heart of the evidence rather than the sort of bumper sticker statements that the other side liked to make and couldn't defend very well in court. As Sandy mentioned earlier, there were 17 witnesses for us and 2 witnesses for the other side. Elon Meyer talked about the meaning of marriage and how the words domestic partnership and civil union are inadequate. It's a separate but equal problem, and that it's also very, very clear that children actually do also get the difference. It's not just other adults. And in our case with 4 children, they were very, very clear that the day we were domestic partnered was not a significant day in our family. They didn't know when it was. We don't celebrate the anniversary of our domestic partnership, nor does anyone else. So I think it was pushing back on this idea that, what if you had all the rights of a married couple, but we don't call you married? Would that work? And we said, no, it doesn't work. That's not the same thing.
And then there's some testimony regarding the benefits of marriage. And in particular, Dr. Michael Lamb, who just did an amazing job, talked about how marriage benefits individuals and it benefits families, and it really benefits children. And there is actually documented research that shows that how well children do in families where there is marriage. And in fact, that children that are raised by, you know, intersexual or homosexual couples have equally good outcomes. And in fact, at times, children raised by gay parents have better outcomes. Not to say anything wrong with all the straight families out there. But if you have a child in a gay couple, you can really knock yourself out to have that child. It's not easy. And then the harm of Proposition 8. And this, the harm of Proposition 8 is where we got to some very touching testimony, and you definitely saw some tears in the courtroom. Jerry Sanders, for instance, is a mayor of San Diego, and he talked about how he had been involved in the political process and had been on the side of on the wrong side of the marriage equality issue, and had a gay daughter, and how his views kind of changed along the way, and he ended up really being very much a proponent for equality, saying that if the government tolerates discrimination against anyone for any reason, it becomes an excuse for the public to do the exact same thing. And in fact, there's a lot of anecdotal evidence around that, how people justify their behavior by saying, if the government does it, it must be fine. And then the history of discrimination, and this was one of my very favorite days. This is a fantastic day that you didn't want to miss. And this is where Dr. Gary Segura talked about the political process and how gays have been underrepresented politically. And in fact, there's been so much more harm done for the political process to gays than really any other minority group. And he says, there is no group in American society who has been targeted by ballot initiatives more than gays and lesbians. They have essentially lost 100% of the contests over same-sex marriage. The initiative process has been really the Waterloo of gay and lesbian politics. And he talked about how even mainstream politicians, mainstream senators, have compared gay people to animals. And he said, this is mainstream America, it's not the fringe. What does that say to you about the power that gays and lesbians have politically? It's indeed very, very little.
So the other thing that happened that was really interesting was that not only did we get to call the witnesses that we prepared ourselves, or the team did, but we called the other side's witnesses. In particular, he was a proponent of Proposition 8, he was a minister in San Francisco, and he had been deposed by David Boies, as had many other people, more than 7 or 8. They all withdrew their support of the legal teams in court after they'd been deposed by David Boies. But we had, of course, videotape and transcripts and all kinds of records of those depositions. And so when it came time to show harm, we called 2 of their witnesses as our witnesses. And those were really fascinating days. And this individual in particular was really underlining the animus question. The other side kept saying, no, it's not animus. No, people in California aren't bigots. This was just purely a matter of tradition and families wanting to maintain the sort of traditional marriage. It had nothing to do with not liking gay people. And then we brought up Minister Tam, who really had some awful things to say about LGBT people and likened us to a number of other groups of polygamists and pedophiles, etc. But what was really interesting was when asked, where did he get that information? His answer was, in the internet. Humor, right? So you're saying, oh, so you're leading a campaign in the largest state in the United States, and you're going to win, and you're basing it on something you read on the internet. And it really was, you know, and look, he won. And the other, who is this?
Oh, who is that?
Oh, Greg Harrington.
By day, not this day.
Yeah, well, then we went back to our own witnesses. And Greg Herrick was so great because he's done numerous studies, many of them longitudinal, sort of the gold standard. He's got control groups and experimental groups, and he's really looked at this issue about whether or not, you know, LGBT is a disorder, a dysfunction, and very involved with what's happened with the AMA and the EPA and changing that. Again, going back to, it's not a problem with the people. The problem is the way that government is treating.
That's what's causing the harm. And then,
let's go to Ken Miller.
Yeah.
Well, this is just, I don't
have to
Poor guy.
But what we do want to talk about is, you become really empathic towards people you don't agree with because they look so uncomfortable. And to see a grown man just really struggle in front of the court, no matter what, feel pretty badly for him, and that is what I have to say about this particular witness, is that he had a hard day in court, and it's not fun to get cross-examined by David Boies. That's a very bad day for anyone, so avoid that as much as possible in your life. Now, this person, David Blankenhorn, he got the full force of David Boies' skill in cross-examination. He started out saying the history of marriage and marriage is an institution, we have to hold on to the tradition. By the end of his time on the stand, he was saying, you know what, same-sex marriage would likely contribute to more stability and to longer-lasting relationships with committed same-sex couples. And he goes on to talk about the American idea. And this is great. You can see the question and answering. So this is how Boies just kind of leads him to the conclusion. And as David Blankenhorn says later on, he felt like he could see the train coming and couldn't do anything about it. He saw himself going to this conclusion. And indeed, he says that we would be more American the day that we allow same-sex marriage in our country.
I think this is a good point to go back to the three-tiered strategy before we show you a couple of fun, entertaining clips that underscore some of the what was going on outside the courtroom. But just to remind you, the three-tiered strategy was depoliticized. So even though the other side had brought in witnesses from various backgrounds or political beliefs, they were brought more to the center by being shown their own work and being asked to read their work out loud. That was really helpful. And then there were also a number of public education efforts going on outside the courtroom that were taking phrases and quotes and evidence right out of the courtroom and putting them up on television or print media whenever we could. And then there was this sort of, you know, never-ending legal strategy that unfolded every day. So what we wanted to show you was, because there were no courts, cameras in the courtroom, and there was an ongoing need to raise funds to help offset the cost of the legal team, there was a play made about the case based on the transcript from the trial, and it was called Eight. This was the New York premiere, and this is a clip of it so that you can enjoy. This was the L.A. version.
It's easy for people who want to deprive gays and lesbians of their rights to make all kinds of statements, campaign literature, on TV, where they can't be cross-examined. But the witness stand is a lonely place to lie.
You cannot say after the fact, we are going to take away the constitutional right to liberty, privacy, association that we already tell you you have. That is not acceptable.
I am asking you to tell me how it would harm opposite sex marriages.
All right, Your Honor, my answer is, I don't know.
How convinced are you that you are gay?
I'm convinced because at 47 years old, I have fallen in love one time. It is Chris.
We would love to have a family, but the timeline for us has always been marriage first.
You two are about the most responsible, important, meaningful things I will ever do in my whole life. And don't you ever let anyone ever make you feel any different. You got it?
We put fear and prejudice on trial.
We put fear and prejudice on trial.
Fear and prejudice on trial.
We put fear and prejudice on trial.
The word marriage has a meaning. If it wasn't so important, we wouldn't be here today.
So, after the trial finished, we waited 7 months for a ruling, which might not sound that long, you know, people almost have babies in that amount of time. A long time to wait to find out whether we won or lost, and I was as happy as anybody on this stage when Vaughn Walker, the Chief Justice of the Federal Court in San Francisco, issued his ruling in August 2010. And it was a magnificent ruling. There were more than 80 findings of fact, and they were remarkable. And I wanted to share one of them with you here today, which is that because California has no interest in discriminating against gay men and lesbians, and because Proposition 8 prevents California from fulfilling its constitutional obligation to provide marriages on an equal basis, the court concludes that Prop 8 is unconstitutional. That was a great day. That was a great day. And as someone who grew up in America, it never felt terribly patriotic because I didn't feel protected. It really changed my whole perspective on being an American to go through a process where someone like me, that had been typically excluded, felt like the process to say this isn't fair worked. I know that's not always the case, but I know that's why you're here, because you believe it does work. And these rules do create change in a way that is two steps forward, one step back. It's not the whole country, it's still a big fight, but you know, we chip away. And this is a remarkable thing, and these findings get used now over and over and over again.
And then it says victory again, but a few things happen before we have victory. Through the appeal court. And the first thing that happened, right after the ruling, basically, the proponents asked the court to dismiss the ruling because Vaughn Walker was a gay judge. And it's the thing is, it wasn't unknown to everybody. It was a known fact. And in fact, early on, the lawyers had said to the other side, are you going to make an issue of this? They had said no. But they then indeed then asked for the judgment to be vacated because of that, and that was tossed out. So that didn't go further, but it was considered by many to be like a sort of a low point in the process. And then, of course, we did go on to the appeal, and we won an appeal, the appellate level, which was a great victory again. And we have, you know, the detours. We visited the California Supreme Court along the way around the issue of standing. But then we did eventually, of course, it did get appealed to the Supreme Court, and it was taken. And we're going to now take a look at inside the oral argument. And this is a brief clip just to kind of show you the players and hear from their voices as well, instead of just us.
the day before we go to the Supreme Court to hear Tim Olson, Solicitor General, arguing our case in front of the Supreme Court. So today, in order to get ready, we're going to the National Archives to see the U.S. Constitution, which is a huge highlight for both Sandy and I and our kids.
We're definitely excited to be here. We're proud to be here. We're certainly nervous, cautiously optimistic, but most importantly, we're hopeful.
Right now, we're just preparing for the argument and to go through and make sure that we have every possible question, every possible argument on the other side, and we've done as much as we can to prepare and respond to it.
When we set out 4 years ago, we said we were going to make this case before the Supreme Court, for the highest court in the land, and I think we're all going to be just in awe to watch Ted Olson up there making our case.
It's a dialogue among the justices. They use their questions to explore issues, so you can't read too much into anything.
Well, we think history will look back and feel proud that our country came together to support equality for all people, and we're just so grateful that we get to be part of this very important civil rights issue.
We're Chris and Sandy's sons, so, I mean, we just tag along for the ride. Try to make them look good. I think I'm going to have to move to
the Supreme Court. Tomorrow morning we'll get up very early, and we will make our way to the Supreme Court. Sounds strange to say it out loud.
We have great clients. They are loved. They want to get married.
But this is the defining civil rights issue of our generation. It is a time that I think that we advance the agenda of equality, not just for gays and lesbians, but for everybody.
It's freezing,
but of course I'm so excited to be here.
We've been on the case for a very, very long time, and it's been a great journey, and we've accomplished a lot so far.
So I'm trying to wrap my head around the fact that this is actually real and happening, and we're here, but it's incredibly exciting and historic morning. This is exactly what our judicial system is for, and this is where we should be on this day.
Made this possible by their generous support. We want to thank them for it. And the fact that millions of people around the country that have worked so hard to make this possible.
To me, this whole of this work, everything that we're doing, is about the next generation. So that the young people out there who are just coming of age, falling off for the first time, they do so without judgment.
I know what I'm going to be seeing from our side. Ted Olson is going to be brilliant, as he always is, and he will make the points that we feel necessary.
It's incredible, you know, it's a historic day for the LGBT rights movement.
I'm anxiously waiting for June. I'm already nervous. I'm like, okay, do they have it yet? Did they decide? It's only been 10 minutes.
It's a little bit of a relief, but at the same time, now we wait. And we know we have to wait for 3 months before we find out what they've decided.
The most important battle, I think, clearly has been won. But when you have that when there was again sitting in the back of Harvey's old camera store on Castro Street, Harvey saying, you've got to come out, and it's pretty extraordinary.
We're not done in this movement for LGBT equality. So next is get back to work and keep fighting to make sure the next generation's lives are better than ours. I think that's our job as Americans.
Good news came 3 months later, that we won on a 5-4 vote, but not in the way that we hoped. They did recognize that the other side didn't have standing, and even though the California Supreme Court and other courts had thought that they did, the Supreme Court said they did not. But the good news from that was that in California, marriage equality was restored, just as Professor Dorf mentioned to you earlier. And Sandy and I were in this wonderful position of not only having that to go home to, but also Delmon had been struck down on the very same day. And that meant going home to be really married. Really married. Not just California married, but really married. And we had so many people on our side that you saw in that clip, people that worked really hard to raise the money, people who worked really hard to raise visibility, people who were on both sides of the political spectrum, who came together on strategy and worked everywhere they could. And then it got us this. We got married. We were the first couple to get married in California immediately after the Ninth Circuit lifted the stay that they had placed at the time of the appeal. And there's a funny story that goes with this, but maybe we can tell it during the Q&A of where we got dressed. It was in our law office. So don't ever, ever get ready for your wedding at the law office. Not a fun thing to do. So those are our sort of behind the scenes comments, and we're really excited to hear questions from Professor and Paul.
Okay, so we're going to have a seat. I'll ask a few questions, then we'll open it up. So each of you, I think, mentioned how well taken care of you felt as a consequence of having these lawyers. I guess I want to know whether you felt like real clients all the way, right? That is to say, so most of the clients I represent are clients like you guys, that is to say, where it's a pro bono case, it's impact litigation, we've got a certain goal. But as a lawyer, when I do that, I understand that officially you're still the client. So did you ever feel like thinking, you know what, maybe we don't want to go ahead with this case, and that you could, you know, treat them as your lawyers, as your sort of your personal lawyers, rather than as, you know, you are the named plaintiffs of this big case?
I'll take a stab at that. I think that we felt like a large group of people were the plaintiffs. And so, no, it wasn't as you described. It typically is a one-on-one relationship with a plaintiff and an attorney, and together you decide how far you're going to go with this thing. This felt so much bigger than that. At times, we probably wish we had been more in the driver's seat because so many parts of it were terrifying. And maybe it's just as well that we couldn't, because there were a number of days we woke up and said, how do we get out of this? How can we get this to stop? Because the anxiety before trial was immense, and there were moments that things were happening that were scary. We were singled out. We were approaching the courthouse on many, many occasions where people were picketing and screaming, and we had our kids with us. And there are times you feel like, is this worth it? I mean, you question, but you can't stop.
And yet, one thing that I remember Ted in particular did that I thought was very helpful for us is every time we saw him, he would come right up to us and say, I think about you every day. I'm in this case for you, the two of you. And to make that direct connection for us as the client made us feel very much remembered in the whole sea of the issues that we were confronting.
So here's another question. As I mentioned in the overview, the initial reaction of the major organizations was officially supportive but cool, and behind the scenes something between miffed and really annoyed, right? Did you feel any of that?
We came along a little bit after some of that negotiation had happened, and we did feel it in the sense that there was a certain amount of skepticism or scrutiny, I think, which honestly was fair. I think if you've been working for decades on an issue and you know who the leaders are and you look at who AFER has and you don't recognize anybody, you should question their credentials. You should question their ability to do this. And so I always felt, by the time we arrived, that the skepticism or scrutiny directed at us was fair. And I think over time, the support grew because they saw us living up to the expectations they had for us. And so it really changed to very positive, and very early on, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that we were so acutely aware of the contributions of all these other groups, whether or not they completely agree with our strategy. Without the contributions of so many for so many years before us, we couldn't have been as successful in our case, and nobody, and our contribution helped somebody else be successful. So there are so many interdependencies, and we tried to kind of steer that course of fidelity to the approach that we were taking, as well as a great deal of appreciation for everybody else's hard work too. And nothing was more important. It was all very important.
So I've got two more questions, and I think I'm going to open up. So there's this new book that we were talking about beforehand about sort of inside story on litigation and sort of where it, a little bit about where it fits into the movement more broadly. So I heard the author on Fresh Air yesterday with Terry Gosson. One of the things that apparently she talks about in the book that I learned for the first time on the radio is that Charles Cooper, who is the lead lawyer for the sponsors, the defenders of Prop 8, apparently found out during the course of the trial that his daughter was a lesbian and wanted to get married. So I realize he didn't cross-examine either of you during the trial. Did he cross-examine you during the deposition?
No, the depos were done by the Alliance Defense Fund. And to Cooper, I think this is the most perfect example of what we were trying to do. We were not really speaking to Ted Olson. We already supported marriage equality. We weren't even speaking to the other LGBT leadership groups or lawyers. Sandy and I always felt like we were trying to speak to people like Chuck Cooper, who wasn't on our side, and to let him get to know us a little bit and understand what our lives were like. And we were feeling that same way about people we would never meet. So when we found out that when he was in the middle of this process, he learned that someone he loved was gay, and he still loved them. It was like, this was exactly the point of doing this for us. We weren't trying to go down in history as, you know, great Supreme Court lawyers or fabulous political strategists. We were trying to speak the truth so that other people would change their mind. And that was the most amazing revelation, that is what had happened to him, and that he was affected by our testimony. He says he is.
And we had moments, actually, even in the courtroom, with Chuck Cooper. His wife was there almost every day, and his daughter was there, not the gay daughter, but a different one, many days in court. And, you know, we would pass him in the hallway and smile at each other, because, you know, that's what you do if you're a reasonable person. After the Supreme Court hearing, he came down and happened to run into Chris and gave her a hug, you know, kind of like, good game, good fight. And so, you know, you really, between having Ted as our lawyer, and realizing that we could be on different sides of many issues, but really come together on this one, I think we had that same experience with many of the lawyers, and we thought, you know, we're not as far apart as we may seem, and try to find some middle ground.
Okay, so my last question, then I'll open it up. So the Supreme Court ruling was weird, right?
Yes.
And it's part of what I think made it weird was that the justices who voted in the way that enabled you to sort of win included justices who are likely to be on the other side when the case gets there. So I'm interested in how it felt to win the way that you won the Supreme Court.
You know, we came in, first of all, we didn't really know we were going to trial, and we never really thought we were going to Supreme Court. So the whole thing becomes increasingly surreal. When the day comes, and you know it's the day they're going to rule because it's the last day of the session, and they only have one case left to read. At that point, you'll almost take anything. I mean, we were, you know, just please let us not lose. You know, it's to get put things into context. I mean, to have the pleasure of the lawyer sitting back and now looking at who voted which way, what did they say, and how did they say it, is very meaningful, and I care about that context. But to put it in the real life experience of sitting there and hearing that they went 5-4 to essentially strike down Prop 8, but not on merit, was this bittersweet, but okay, we'll take it kind of moment. And really, the bigger thrill was coming out of the Supreme Court and the faces of so many LGBT friends and supporters, seeing the relief and the joy in their faces over both rulings. The combination was just so powerful.
Yeah. We would have loved to have had a win that was not on standing. That would have been amazing. We didn't get it. It was initially a little bit difficult for me anyway. I remember Ted Olson's wife, Lady, saying, "This is a great day. Don't be disappointed. We, you know, we won DOMA and we won in California. It's amazing." And that was amazing. And of course, to see a well-wishers when you're walking out of the courtroom helps you feel that joy in a more of a kind of community in a broader way.
Okay. Okay, so we're going to open up to questions. If you have a question for, in particular, Chris or Sandy, you can say that, or just a general question.
And we'll bring microphones out to you, so that's being recorded, so that way I can do it here.
Yes. Oh, wait. Okay.
Raise your hand high.
Hi, so thanks for coming. I really appreciate it. It was a really interesting talk. I have two kind of related questions. So I was living in California at the time, and I remember as I was leaving the ballot booth that day that I thought, there's no way that it's actually going to pass. So I was wondering, what were your impressions? What were you thinking? Did you expect it to pass? And relatedly, was that sort of like the galvanizing moment that you decided you wanted to get involved, or was it what was kind of the process that led you to want to be so involved?
Professor Dorf asked us that before the talk, and we said we didn't think it would pass. We didn't think we had a 6-month window. I mean, that's all, again, perfect hindsight. You can look back and say, why didn't you go? I mean, you knew you had a 6-month window. We didn't know that. We thought it would be fine. We were really caught up in the presidential election, really excited about that. We weren't paying as much attention to Prop 8 because it didn't look like it was going to pass in California, for heaven's sakes. We were Berkeley. I mean, we weren't even living in California, we live in Berkeley, right? So, really, it's hard to get your head around the possibility that this could actually happen. And of course, it was a very narrow win, but it went nonetheless. And we were devastated. It actually took all the joy out of the presidential election, and it took months. Really, months to build up the anger about it that we got to when we were approached. I mean, we were at a point where we just couldn't stand it anymore. And I worked in Sacramento. I was running a state agency. I was part of that administration. And I felt more and more like I didn't even want to work in the state of California anymore. It really became very, very personal.
And in regards to then wanting to take action into our own hands and do something about it, we were just like every other Californian, like just living with this terrible situation, the changed constitution. We weren't the ones who had this brilliant idea to go to the federal court. Somebody else did, and then we were approached to see if we would join the lawsuit. And of course, we did it. We thought it was a great idea, but it was somebody else's idea, and they put it together and then set out to find plaintiffs to represent the case.
Are we that intimidating? What's it called? Cold calling?
Should
I do that?
But they don't forgive you.
I also wanted to thank you for coming, and the Times actually a few days ago on Sunday had an article about the difficulty of being the face of major litigation, and in that context it was antitrust and dealing with that, but to me this has to have been that much more difficult. You talked about there being some days when you were thinking, how can I get out? And I was just wondering, what were your support structures to be able to like make it through such a long process, through ups and downs of all of that?
Can I add one piece to Chris? Was it worse for you as the Perry, as opposed, right? Because it's your name there, right?
Right. Yeah, maybe. That too took a long time to fully register. So it happened on the first day of trial. I saw poster that said Perry versus Schwarzenegger, and I'd never seen my name listed as the only name, and that was right before we were about to testify. I thought, this is just too much. So maybe a little bit hard, but we ended up being each other's biggest support, and no one else could understand it. Nobody else could understand it. Our kids were terrific. They helped a lot by not only being supportive, but not making sure they didn't need as much support, which is a huge gift for, adolescent children, young adult children. I don't need to tell you what that's like, right? You have four boys running around, they're hungry, and
got to the point where they were actually not doing that as much. So we got that kind of support, and then we were very aware of what each other's, you know, experience was. And anybody here, you know, we get really dear friends or family or partners. There's some that are going through something really hard together that brings you closer together. We're very fortunate to think that that happened here. And of course, there are friends too. And we aren't, we don't mean to sound like we're overstating the support from the law team, legal team, but honestly, we would never have lasted without them. They were amazing.
And we had another thing called the martini, and that was.
I guess on that, the flip side of that, and I even hate to ask this, but I do wonder, was there any ugliness directed at you? I assume there was.
You know, for a time, we started getting phone calls, really hostile phone calls from a stranger, at, like every few minutes, all night long, you know, and really was very ugly messages. And we got to a point where a couple times the kids answered the phone. So we just said, do not answer the phone unless you know who's calling. And then we actually had to get the authorities involved, and that went forward. And after that happened, and that person actually is incarcerated now, but after that happened, we increased security on our home significantly. We put a security system in. We changed our phone number. We made sure any references to where we lived or our phone number were, as much as possible, taken off of any website where they may have been because we were involved in PTA and things like that. So that was probably the hardest and most intimidating part of it. And, you know, as after the trial was finished and we were a little bit less in the media and things kind of settled down, then we became, you know, we're less nervous then. But for a while, we were very, very vigilant to the point of, like, don't walk outside unless somebody's walking out with. We closed the shades when we got home, even if it was still daylight, just because we wanted to make sure that we were okay and the kids were okay.
Actually, that's a great segue into my question. With all of these arguments swirling around you and with all of the, I suppose, just burden making you so tired. I imagine you must have been exhausted at points during this. Was there any point at which the opposition succeeded in getting you to doubt that you were right?
No. Not even one time. No, they tried. They were getting a little redundant. You know, I think I mentioned the bumper sticker problem they were having. They, you know, the campaign to get Prop 8 passed, as you may recall or I'll remind you, was all about protect the children. So they were using this really subtle sort of covert language that has been used for decades against gays, that we are a problem, that we have bad judgment, we try to recruit children, we do these things, which are not proven in evidence at all. And so that campaign had sort of subtly woven that history into the campaign, and it was obviously successful. When they came to court, they couldn't use any of those slogans because there was no evidence to support it. So they started shifting their argument over and over again, and it got worse and worse. That's why I said no. They were trying to talk about how, you know, procreation was the point of marriage. Even the judge pushed back on them there and said, just yesterday I married 2 9-year-olds in chambers. I don't think they're inappropriate. You know, it was to the point where nothing was sticking. And finally, just this idea that tradition, and we have the witness we showed you, Nancy Cobb, who said it's not a static institution, it's a very dynamic institution, and that is an unfair argument. So, no.
I have 2 unrelated questions, but I wanted to put them in. So the first is, when you were so busy with deposition prep and trial prep, were you able to take time off work, and like, were your jobs cool with that? And the second question, when the movie is made about this, who do you want to play you?
Oh, which one do you want? The movie question or the vacation question?
Well, first of all, didn't you think the people in the play really resembled us? I thought, how did they find them?
We used all of our vacation for 5 years to be in a case. We didn't take a vacation. Because there was no other way to be away for either court appearances or preparation and also travel without using vacation days. And Sandy, I'm not in public service anymore, but at the time I was, and so we were very careful to separate our employment from the case so that no one would ever say, well, you're using your position to be a plaintiff. So now on to more fun things. Who would play us in a movie?
Oh, that's the better part.
Naomi Watts.
Yeah, absolutely.
That
was obvious.
And Rachel Maddow.
That's a small detail. So.
I think I want to hear more about your post-litigation life. You said up to the point when you got involved with the litigation, you were carrying on with your ordinary life, but now you became sort of a public figure and well-known to others in your vicinity, probably. But so now are you fully got back to your normal life, or are you like engaged in a lot of events like this? How were your daily lives have been?
You know, our lives vacillate between doing laundry and cleaning bathrooms and coming to Cornell, which is really exciting, going to work, which is most of the time. Right now, we're actually very busy doing kind of things that are related to the case because, as the professor talked about, the book that just came out called Forcing Them Spring by Joe Becker, that's, there's a certain amount of activities surrounding that book. And then two other books will be coming out, and we'll help with those as well to the degree that were needed. And there's also a documentary that's going through the documentary film festivals right now, and that talks about the case, and we're in that. So we've gone and done a number of panels. This is all the fun stuff, you know. After these things wind down, probably by July, it should settle down quite a lot, and then just occasionally speaking to groups and doing everything we can to advocate for the success of other cases that are pending in the country, and everything we can do to promote kind of embedding the principles of equality and human development into education and speaking to schools and kids groups. We've done some college speaking engagements like this and some high school. It's really great to go to groups in different schools, especially at the lower levels, and talk about how very important it is to let younger people know about the options that are available to them so that they can grow up feeling like they live in an inclusive society, and they don't have to feel scared, they don't have to feel ashamed about who they are. And I think for us as mothers, that was always the thing we wanted to drive home, that we have to protect our children, and this is actually protecting the children, and that we're responsible for the future generation, and we just take that seriously.
I have a short follow-up. So there's a group of people who are in this status, right? And eventually there will be whoever's name comes first on the case that ultimately gets to the U.S. Supreme Court. And in a way, it'll be weird because it'll probably be like the Attorney General of Utah, right? Because Utah will be appealing, right? But there'll be a plaintiff in that case. So are you in touch with any of that, like with Goodridge or with, you know, or with any of the Varney, one of you is from Iowa.
Sandy.
Barnum, Vermont, right? Is there like a community of
plaintiffs? There is a Facebook group. I know. It's true. LGBT plaintiff Facebook group. We're in that. I don't look at it a lot. There are obviously, you know, a number of very famous plaintiffs that preceded us who we don't know, with the exception of Edie Windsor, who we do know and admire immensely. And it would be our honor to meet some of the others. And I think we will. I think over time, with all of the places we all end up, yeah, we will have that. I really hope so. We've met a number of the advocates and pundits and spokespeople and attorneys, but it's been hard to meet the plaintiffs.
Other questions?
So I was actually just curious, you actually reinstated the question I was interested in terms of you returning to a life of normalcy, but what do you feel is the next step, I guess, in terms of just beyond marriage equality? Because, I mean, that's just the first step, but going beyond that, what would you feel is, I guess, should be the next, I guess, the main issue that the LGBTQ community should address?
Well, the next really pressing issue is ENDA, which is the Employment Discrimination Act, that really, we hope, in this administration, when it can be dealt with through executive order, is done away with. And what that really means is, if Sandy and I lived in certain states, and we were legally married, we could be fired for having a picture of each other on our desk and telling people we were married, because there's still no protection for LGBTQ employees. Now that has such a, that just cuts to the core of your survival, I think, and in a different way than not being able to get married does. So I think that the next frontier, honestly, facing LGBT advocates is employment discrimination, because it has such a, immediate effect on your ability to be self-sufficient and provide for your partner and your family. And I think that's where a lot of people's attention is turning soon.
And of course, there are endless opportunities at the international level, because when you look at the international community, there's horrific injustices occurring today against LGBT people.
Hi, so my question is, I hate to bring it backwards looking so forward, but I promise I'll end with a forward-looking question. So I have two related questions. The first is, in 2008, I was one of the very surprised people when Proposition 8 passed. And I was wondering if Proposition 8 passing, and especially the ease of California's constitutional amendment process, made you doubt the political system, the way that the system protects individuals, and whether this case and the way it has worked and the way the process has worked since then has rehabilitated your view of the political process since then.
In California, I didn't realize this until we ended up with the California Supreme Court on standing, that the ballot initiative or referendum process that's been in California for almost 90 years it really is this direct legislative method that has been embraced for so long now in California that people can create legislation at the ballot box. It's very unusual. And I think I'm not a big fan, because there's no filter between what anyone wants to write and ask other people to vote on and what may or may not be constitutional. And perhaps if there were some way for that vetting to occur, I'd be more or less okay with it. But it really created a huge rupture in the state, not just politically, but I mean literally personally, neighbors not understanding neighbors. We would go to a county clerk's office and upset and alienate staff just by asking for a marriage license. It was harming people that had nothing to do with that vote, because they were the people in charge of implementing that law or watching you not get to be married. I mean, everybody felt ashamed of it. So I don't know that I'd say undo it, but I don't know that it's fair to be quite so direct. That somebody like William Tam can just sit down at his computer and write something up, and next thing you know, it's on a ballot.
All right, thank you again, everybody. Unless there are any final questions. All right, thank you again, everybody, for coming. For anybody interested, we do have some time in the lounge.